Hello and welcome to Inside Ophthalmology. I am Dr. Amrit, and in today's lecture from our corneal dystrophy series, we will discuss the TGF beta 1 related stromal dystrophies, specifically the lattice corneal dystrophy and the granular corneal dystrophy. Let's begin with the lattice corneal dystrophy. It is the most common stromal dystrophy worldwide, and it is actually caused by the mutations in the TGF beta 1 gene, also known as the big H3, located on chromosome 5q. Now, patients usually present in the first or second decade of life, and a typical history here includes recurrent corneal erosions, which cause pain and photophobia. On slit-lamp examination, we will see refractive branching lines in the anterior and in the mid-stroma. As the disease progresses, these lines may thicken, they may branch further and merge together. In the early stages, the stroma between the lattices often remains clearer. Now, this picture over here shows the characteristic doubly refractile branching lines with a clear core and overlapping lattice pattern under the retroillumination. Now, in early diseases, you may also notice sometimes glassy refractile dots, which later evolve into fine branching lines. And with time, with long-standing lattice dystrophy, you might find a diffuse stromal haze developing between the lattices, leading to progressive visual impairment in these long-standing cases. There are two clinical variants of the lattice corneal dystrophy, type 1 and type 2. The type 1 is the classic form and is considered a corneal dystrophy, whereas type 2 is not considered a corneal dystrophy. The type 1, the classic one, is linked to the TGFβ1 gene mutation, and it is an isolated ocular disease with no systemic involvement. Type 2, on the other hand, is associated with a different mutation known as the Gel-Solin mutation, and unlike the type 1, it has systemic features in addition to the corneal changes. Patients with type 2 may actually develop cranial neuropathies, facial paralysis, and characteristic facial features. As you can see over here, they might develop premature aging, reduced forehead wrinkling, mask-like faces, floppy ears, protruding lower lip, cutis laxa, which is nothing but loose skin. This is also seen in pseudoxanthoma elasticum. So this could be found here in the Mariposa syndrome as well. They may also show blepharochilasis, that is the redundant loose eyelid skin. So here's a quick summary. Inheritance, both type 1 and type 2 are autosomal dominant inherited. And the age of onset, for type 1, it usually starts before 10 years of age, while for type 2, it presents later between 20 to 35 years of age. The vision in type 1 often declines after 40 years due to stromal haze, whereas in type 2, the vision tends to remain good until about 65 years. Erosions are more frequent in type 1, but they are uncommon in type 2. And when we talk about the systemic involvement, it is absent in type 1, but in type 2, you may see amyloid deposits in the skin, blood vessels, and other organs, along with the cranial nerve paralysis and the facial features I just described. Now let's talk about the pathology. The hallmark of lattice corneal dystrophy is the deposition of amyloid in the anterior stroma. These localized amyloid deposits can disrupt the epithelium, they can disrupt the Bowman's layer and stroma, but the endothelium and the desmoid membrane remains normal. On histopathology, the amyloid appears eosinophilic on the H&E stain and is positive and stains positive with Congo red, thioflavin T, and crystal violet. And under polarized light, and stained after staining with Congo red, it shows the classic apple green birefringence, which is a favorite examination question. On electron microscopy, you might see the 7 to 10 nanometers amyloid fibrils along with keratocyte vacuolization. So this picture over here shows per iodic acid skiff stained fusiform amyloid deposit in the anterior stroma. And here, the same lesions, when stained with Congo red, appear reddish. And when viewed under polarized light, they give the characteristic apple green birefringence. A few important clinical pearls is that recurrent erosions are common in lattice corneal dystrophy, more so in the type 1, and especially seen in the younger age group in the first decade of life. And the visual loss, however, will occur in their 40s, and that occurs because of the progressive stromal haze development. It's important to differentiate lattice dystrophy from other stromal dystrophies such as granular and macular dystrophies, which are discussed further. This image illustrates the recurrent erosions in a patient with lattice dystrophy along with typical lattice lines which are seen in both diffuse and retroillumination here. Finally, let's look at the management. The main goals are here to relieve recurrent erosions and restore vision. So conservative treatment includes lubricating eye drops, hypertonic saline, and banded contact lenses, debridement of the recurrent erosions. The rationale behind the conservative management has already been discussed in our previous videos on corneal dystrophy. For surgical options, we have phototherapeutic keratectomy that can be used for anterior stromal deposits. And if there are deeper stromal deposits affecting the vision, but the endothelium is healthy, you can do a deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty. In cases with full thickness haze, limiting vision sometimes, even a penetrating keratoplasty could be indicated. It is important to remember, however, that recurrence is possible even after keratoplasty, especially anterior recurrence in case of lattice dystrophy. The next dystrophy that we are going to talk about is the granular corneal dystrophy. According to the IC3D classification, it is also a TGFβ1 related stromal dystrophy, and it also follows an autosomal dominant inheritance with high penetrance and is caused by mutations in the TGFβ1 gene, that is a big H3 on chromosome number 5. There are three main subtypes, however, of GCD. These are GCD type 1, type 2, and type 3. The type 1 is known as the classic or the Granau type 1, and it's caused by the R555W mutation. The GCD type 2 is also known as the Avellino dystrophy or the granular lattice dystrophy, caused by the R124H mutation. It combines the features of both granular and lattice dystrophy. Then we have the GCD type 3, which is also known as the Bowman's layer dystrophy type 1 or the Rees-Buckler's corneal dystrophy, caused by the mutations in ARG24LU mutation. And this we discussed already in our previous video. So let's discuss the first type, that is the classic form of granular corneal dystrophy type 1. The onset here is usually in the first or second decade of life. The patients present with recurrent corneal erosions. However, the erosions here are rarer compared to the type 2. So photophobia is also milder compared to the type 2 and also compared to the lattice dystrophy. On slit-lamp, you will see small, white, sharply demarcated deposits in the anterior stroma. Now, they have been described as looking like breadcrumbs sometimes. Sometimes they are described as snowflakes or popcorn-like. The intervening stroma remains clear initially, and with time, the deposits will increase in number and they will coalesce, eventually impairing the vision by fourth or fifth decade of life. An important point is that the periphery of the cornea, 2 to 3 millimeters from the limbus, is typically spared in these conditions. The opacities in the GCD1 can vary in shape, and in this image, as you can see, how they look opaque in direct focal illumination, but sometimes they will look more translucent in retroillumination. Notice also the annular figure over here. The second picture again shows the variety of shapes seen in the granular dystrophy. Now, typically, the opacities start as breadcrumb-like deposits, fewer in number, and they gradually spread centrifugally as the disease progresses. Now let's move on to the granular corneal dystrophy type 2, also called the Avellino dystrophy or the granular lattice dystrophy. This is caused by the mutation in R124H in the TGFβ1 gene. The onset is similar to the GCD1, but the disease is more progressive. The recurrent erosions here are more common than the GCD1. Moreover, in homozygous cases, the onset can be very early, even 3 to 5 years of age. On slit lamp examination, the GCD2 shows a combination of granular and lattice deposit. In granular deposits, which are hyaline basically, it appears breadcrumb-like and they are found in the anterior stroma. The lattice deposits, which are the amyloid deposits, they appear as refractive lines and they are found in the mid to deep stroma. Over time, a stromal haze will develop, further reducing the vision. So here are some of the clinical images. You can see deposits of different sizes and shapes, some larger, some smaller, some stellate and even annular figures. When you see a stellate figure superficially along with the linear deposits deeper, think of GCD type 2. Now, important clinical pearl over here is that patients with granular corneal dystrophy type 2 should not undergo laser refractive surgeries such as LASIK, PRK or SMILE, as these can trigger a rapid progression of the dystrophy. Alright, the third variant is the GCD3, also known as the Rees-Buckler dystrophy or Bowman's layer dystrophy type 1. We have already discussed this in our video on Bowman's layer dystrophy, so I will not go into detail here. Now let's look at the histopathology of the granular corneal dystrophy. The deposits here are made up of hyaline. Alright, so in lattice dystrophy we have amyloid deposits, and in granular dystrophy we have hyaline deposits. These deposits appear eosinophilic on HRE stain, and typically they stain bright red with a Masson's trichrome, but not so well with the pars staining. On electron microscopy, they look like rod shape or trapezoid shaped structures and appear as electron dense structures. In Avellino type, that is the granular corneal dystrophy type 2, you will find both hyaline and amyloid deposits. The hyaline deposits will be stained positively with Masson's trichrome, whereas the amyloid will stain positively with Congo red and will also depict the apple green birefringence under the polarized light. In the early stages, the intervening stroma is clear and the endothelium remains normal. Now here's an image of the GCD1 on histology showing red staining hyaline deposits with Masson trichrome. Another picture here demonstrates the sharply demarcated breadcrumb-like opacities that are seen in the slit section. Now let's talk about the management of granular dystrophy. This is pretty similar to the lattice dystrophy. Conservative treatment is for erosions. You can use lubricants, hypertonic saline, bandage contact lenses and epithelial debridement. Then we can do a phototherapeutic keratectomy for superficial lesions and deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty or penetrating keratoplasty in advanced cases. Important clinical pearl to remember is laser refractive procedures are contraindicated in GCD2 as they can precipitate rapid progression of the disease. Let's quickly summarize the high yield pearls for granular corneal dystrophy. The inheritance is autosomal dominant. Gene involved is TGFβ1. Subtypes are GCD1, GCD2, GCD3. GCD1 has only hyaline deposits. GCD2 has hyaline and amyloid deposits both. GCD3 is the Rees-Buckler dystrophy or the Bowman's layer dystrophy with painful recurrent erosions. Pathology wise, hyaline deposits stained with Masson's trichrome. Amyloid stains with Congo red and show apple green birefringence. And with this, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you so much for watching. And if you are enjoying our series, stay tuned, share this video with your friends because we're trying to reach 100K soon. Thank you and have a nice day.